dear viewers and listeners. This is another episode of our season 7 of my weekly online chemistry class. As I used to say, do not forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel and try to also like and comment whenever you are watching our videos. Thanks for watching. In the previous episode, we discussed the details, electron affinity, which is a property of an element in its free state and the ability of an atom to, the energy released when an atom gains electrons in its gaseous state. And I told you in that episode, the trend of electron affinity both across the period and down the group of the periodic table. Likewise, we talked about some exceptions to the general trend in terms of why a particular element in a position in the periodic table is having a lower or higher electron affinity than another element against what is expected. Today, we are going to discuss electronegativity. And at the end of this class, you should be able to identify the most electronegative element in the periodic table and the least. And you must be able to also tell us the variation in electronegativity in the periodic table. And likewise, what are the differences between electronegativity and electron affinity of elements, as well as factors that affect electronegativity values. Electronegativity, by definition, is a measure of the tendency or ability of an atom or element to attract bonding electrons to itself in a covalent molecule. That means electronegativity is a property of an element in its bonded state when it is in a molecule, compared to ionization energy and electron affinity, which are properties of elements in its free state. So electronegativity, by definition, as I explained earlier, is a measure of the ability of an element to attract bonding electrons to itself in a covalent molecule. And in general, if you remember, when we talk about electron affinity, I gave an instance of an element X in gaseous state attracting electrons to itself to form an ion in gaseous state. And I told you that the energy released in this process is called electron affinity, which is usually negative. Why the affinity of this atom to attract this electron to itself can be referred to as electronegativity. The opposite of electronegativity is what we call electropositivity. And electropositivity, as against electronegativity, is a measure of the ability of an atom to release electrons to another atom in a molecule. We are coming to that. So in general, electronegativity increases across the period from left to right and decreases down the group from top to bottom of the periodic table. And there are some factors that are responsible for that. One of those factors are the atomic number. The atomic number, which is a function of the size of the atom. The second factor is the nuclear charge. Nuclear charge or size here. Why the third might be effect of, the substituent group. Substituent groups. So how does atomic number or size of an atom affect electronegativity? As we go from top to bottom down the group, we discover that there is increase in atomic number. Likewise, there is increase in effective nuclear charge. But the effect of nuclear charge has been cancelled out as a result of increase in the size of the atom by addition of another shell. So if you go from top to bottom in the periodic table, take for instance group two, where you have beryllium, you have magnesium, you have calcium as an instance, as an example. Beryllium, atomic number 4, 12, 20. This is 2, 2. This is 2, 8, 2. And this is 2, 8, 8, 2. You can see that as you are going down the group, there is increase in the size. Beryllium having 4, 2 shells. magnesium 3 and calcium 4. So the valence electrons get more farther away from the nucleus. And as a result of that, there is decrease in electrostatic force of attraction between the positively charged nucleus of the atom and the valence electron that is attached. So as a result of that, it becomes more difficult for the atom to release electrons. To gain electron rather. So in that case, we can say due to the smaller size of beryllium, beryllium has more tendency to attract bonding electrons to itself than magnesium, which also has more tendency to attract bonding electrons to itself than calcium. So that is how the size of the atom affects the electronegativity. But electropositivity, on the other hand, we can say calcium is more electropositive than magnesium. Why? Because the valence electron to be released is more farther away from the nucleus, thereby reducing the nuclear force between that positively charged of the nucleus and the electrons to be removed. So it is much more easier for calcium to lose electrons than magnesium. So as you go from top to bottom down the group, electropositivity increases, but electronegativity decreases. And that's why we say metals have the least electropositivity, electronegativity value, in any period of the periodic table. While on the other hand, they have the highest electropositivity value because of their ability to easily release bonding electrons to another atom. The other factor, which is nuclear charge, I've explained this on several times. The effective nuclear charge is just the overall nuclear force fed by the valence electron compared. If you look at nuclear charge means the total positive charge in the nucleus. And the effective nuclear charge is normally fed by the electrons outside the nucleus compared to the positively charged of the nucleus. So in that case, as we go from left to right across the period of the periodic table, we observe that there is increase in nuclear charge. If you look at period 2, for instance, which are normally used as an instance, where you have lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen, you see that beryllium, lithium has atomic number 3, 4, 4, boron 5, 6, 7, 8, while the electronic configurations are 2-1, 2-2, 2-3, 2-4, 2-5, and 2-6. So you can observe that as you go across the period, there is increase in atomic number, and there is also increase in nuclear charge. In addition to that, there is increase in the number of electrons in the valence shell. In oxygen, the atomic number is 8, the nuclear charge is 8, but the number of electrons in the valence shell is 6, higher than that of nitrogen, which is higher than that of carbon. So in that case, the size of the atom tends to decrease, and there is increase in the electrostatic force of attraction between the positively charged nucleus and the electrons in the atomic shell. That increase in the nuclear force or nuclear grip thereby increases the electronegativity of the atom. That is why electronegativity tends to increase from left to right across the period. Meaning, the higher the nuclear charge, the higher the electronegativity value of the element. In that case, we can say oxygen has a higher electronegativity than nitrogen compared to boron and others. But in terms of electropositivity, the reverse is the case. The most electropositive element is always on the left, while the least electropositive element is always on the right. For the case of electronegativity, we say the most electronegative is usually the group 17 members of any period in the periodic table. There is one thing I want you to take note of. You observe that ever since we started discussing periodic properties of elements, we never mentioned the group 18, which are group O, the noble, rare, or inert gases. Why? Because they have stable electronic configuration. And in that case, they don't need, their tendency to either lose or gain electrons is very, very low, because their electronic configuration is very, very stable. So in that case, this is the general term. But the most electronegative element in the periodic table is fluorine. That is against what was explained when we consider electron affinity. Because in under electron affinity, I told you that the element with the highest electron affinity was chlorine, higher than that of fluorine. But fluorine is more electronegative than chlorine. I've given you the reason why this has higher electron affinity than this. So electronegativity is a function of the size. That smaller size of the fluorine atom favors its ability to easily attract bonding electrons to itself compared to chlorine. And that cannot explain why this has a higher electron affinity than this, as been strictly explained in the previous episode. So the most electronegative element in the periodic table is fluorine, and that's why most of the compounds formed by fluorine are usually more polar in nature. So, and I told you that electronegativity decreases down the group, so that means fluorine having the highest electronegativity, followed by chlorine, followed by bromine, then iodine, and then astatine in group 17. Why in group 1? Since electronegativity decreases down the group, and we know that group 1 is the first group to be observed in any period of the periodic table. So that means in any period, the group 1 element in that period has the least electronegativity value, while group 17 in that period has the highest electronegativity value. So since this value of electronegativity decreases down the group, then francium or cesium has the least electronegativity value, while fluorine has the highest. And the reverse is the case for electropositivity. The least electronegative element is the most electropositive element. And that's why metals are electropositive in nature, while non-metals are electronegative in nature. Please kindly take care of that. The third factor, substituent groups. The groups that attach to a particular element in the periodic table usually determine the electronegativity of that atom. And this is mostly observed in organic chemistry, in organic compounds where you have inductive effect, both negative inductive effect and positive inductive effect. If you look at carbon, the electronegativity of carbon has a fixed value according to several methods that we are going to discuss in our next episode. So when bromine atoms are attached to this carbon atom, these bromine atoms tend to influence the electronegativity of this carbon atom, either positively or negatively, depending on the nature of the group. But because bromine is more electronegative than carbon atoms, of course you expect the electronegativity of carbon atoms to be a little bit influenced. So the effect of the group will be discussed in details when we get to electronic concepts in organic chemistry. Then another thing you should take note of is that you should observe that electronegativity value has some differences as compared to ionization energy and electron affinity. One of the differences between electronegativity and electron affinity or ionization energy is that electronegativity is a tendency, so it is not an energy quantity. Why electron affinity or ionization energy is an energy quantity? Because they have a particular dimension, they have unit, which can either be in kilojoules per mole or electron volt. But electronegativity is unitless, is dimensionless. And apart from that, both ionization energy and electron affinity are properties of element in its free state, while electronegativity is the property of an element in its combined state with other elements. So as a result of this, you should take note that apart from the fact that generally electronegativity increases across the period from top to bottom, it also decreases down the group, across the period from left to right, it decreases down the group from top to bottom. You must also observe that the most electronegative element was fluorine, and that was due to the smaller size of the atom. Since the higher the size of an atom, the lower the electronegativity value. And the effect of nuclear charge and substituent groups has also been explained. So in our next episode, we are going to discuss or look at the various methods of determining or measuring electronegativity value of elements. And at the same time, we are going to look at how we can use electronegativity difference between two atoms to predict the nature of bond between them, whether the bond will be ionic in nature, polar covalent, or purely covalent. I believe you have learned one or two things concerning electronegativity and electropositivity value. And do not forget that metals are electropositive in nature because they have tendency to easily release electrons. And that properties account for their reducing ability. We refer to them as reducing agents. they have higher reducing property. Why non-metals have higher electronegativity, and as a result of that, they have low reducing capability, and but we can say they have greater oxidizing ability. Thanks for watching, and do not forget to subscribe once again. We'll meet again some other time. Stay safe.